Okay. Do you have any evidence that I support tankies?
No.
I have evidence that you support Nazis. You're a fan of Nick Fuentes.
No. See,
you're a fan of one of the most popular
about is
online Nazi
argument.
Figures
see,
there is
you
right now.
You keep trying to get away from the argument
am I
that I'm
a
having
friend with
you.
Any tankies? Am I buddies with a tankie?
No.
Do you
no,
have any
no,
examples
look,
of that?
Look. Oh my gosh, what you're doing is obfuscating. I don't know what you do in private. Just because you don't overtly, by the way, what you're doing is simply playing
I
optics.
Soak.
You're
I do lots of soaking
up.
In private.
So just because you're covering up the fact that you talk to tankies, you're still furthering your leftist tanky agenda by talking about overtly left-wing things on the internet, which is an attempt to boil the frog by getting people into the left wing.
Comrade.
Mm-hmm.
Forget
yeah,
everything
so,
you have
so basically,
heard.
The most simple way I can say this is
you will
your
not get in the way
line
of our revolution.
Applies just as much to you as it does to me. And what I was interested in is having a conversation with you where you hold me accountable to my words. We could ask simple yes or no questions.
Your social
and, hold
credit
on, hold on.
Score
you could
is
ask
dropping.
Simple yes or no questions. You could ask me, Kai, do you believe this? I'll say yes.
Hey guys, welcome to Politically Provoked, an interactive podcast where we host debates, panels, and interviews. If this is your first time joining us, don't forget to hit that subscribe button as well as the notification bell to keep up to date with all our future debates and panels. So I am your host, Brittany, and I'm here with my co-hosts, Justin and Todd. How are you guys?
Doing great. How are you?
Fabulous. Justin, you're muted.
Doing good. How are you?
Useless.
Yeah, I am useless.
All right, so we are going to be debating immigration today. I'm really excited for this one. It's both of our guests' first time on our debate stage, and it's going to be the first time Xander Hall is coming to our show because I've been trying to get him here for a while, so I'm very excited about that. So first up, let's bring on Kai. How are you?
I am doing wonderful. How about yourself?
Great. So yeah, if you want to introduce yourself, tell people where you lie on the political spectrum and where people can find you.
Yeah, so my name is Kai Clips. I was a TikToker for a while. Now I've got an account that's not officially run by me under the name Kai.Lift. It's mostly lifting content there, but you get something political every once in a while. I lie as a conservative on the political spectrum. I don't really enjoy adding modifiers to that because I think as basic as the ideology gets, it's really just conservatism. So that's where I lie. That's where you can find me. I've got a YouTube channel, Kai Clips, K-A-I space Clips. And besides that, I mean, you're finding me here, which is good enough already.
Love it. All right. Next up, let's bring on Xander Hall. How are you tonight?
Hello there. Thank you for having me on. I'm excited to be talking about some politics, having a little bit of fun debates. And I don't know much about Kai Clips. I took a look at your Twitter and some other stuff beforehand, but I don't know much about you. I've heard some bad things, some good things. So I don't really know what to expect here, but I do like debating the topic of immigration. You're a little dapper right now. You got the drip going. I can appreciate that. And I'm excited to debate. I'm more left-leaning on things. You could call me a liberal or a leftist. I like to say sock dem, but I don't really care about labels as much as the opinions that I hold or other people hold.
And where can people find you?
You can find me on my website, xanderhall.com/live, YouTube under the name Xander Hall, Twitch, Twitter under all the same name.
All right, great. All right, so here's what we're going to do. Each person can give an opening statement about the topic, be 1 to 5 minutes. After that, we will open up the floor. For those of you watching, if you have questions, tag Politically Provoked and who your question is addressed to, and we'll get to them during the Q&A. We're going to do closing statements and final thoughts after the Q&A. So, Kai, would you want to get started with opening statements?
Yeah, sure thing. I want to say, Xander Hall, I'm actually very excited to talk to you. Before this debate was ever planned, I started watching some of your YouTube content, and it's something I've enjoyed actually. So, I'll basically just cut into the debate, and I don't have this written down convoluted thing because I had an experience with that not too long ago, but I'll kind of form up, how I basically see this debate of immigration, which of course is more tailored to the American, context. So I actually want it to be more of an interactive opening so I can kind of judge where you're at and I can assess from there in case I need to elaborate anything else in a particular point so we don't get bogged down explaining things that both of us agree on or something like that. So the first question is kind of, do you have like a background in debate? And I don't mean that as like a snobby question. I mean, just so like you understand kind of the concepts or terms.
No, I don't have much of a background in debate prior to doing this YouTube thing. Everything that I know about debating, I've just learned from practice doing it on the internet. Am I the best debater there is out there? Probably not, but I'm pretty confident in my skills, and I understand most of the lingo and the way that debates work back and forth and how to engage in good faith.
Okay, sweet. So I'm going to play off of a kind of concept in debate, which is like a framework or a particular point of interest, and that in this debate, in my opinion, and you can disagree with me here, is going to be the idea of social capital. You're probably familiar with like that idea being thrown around, especially with this debate. It's defined, I mean, Robert Putnam talks about it a lot, but I'll define it as the networks of relationships among people who live and work in a particular society, enabling that society to function effectively. So I think when we're talking about a nation, when we're talking about any kind of civilization, everything is kind of downstream from social capital. The fact that the people are interacting, the kind of institutions that they exist in are performing well, and that people are a part of a greater thing. Doesn't matter if you believe in nations or not, a kind of coherence and a kind of positive attitude about your surroundings is necessary for anything to function. And that's why I think immigration has been particularly harmful, at least in the American context. I think that what we're seeing is that the standards we might have had about assimilation have been consistently being thrown out the window. And because of that, people don't really relate to each other. I'm going to save this debate from turning into a what is American culture debate. I'll define historic American culture pretty simply as...
Well, hold on. I don't want to be mean. I don't want to interrupt too quickly. This debate is naturally going to evolve into the what is American culture argument. You're arguing right now in favor of the social capital argument, that there is something about allowing immigrants to come to this country that will result in a degradation of the way that we engage in our society, the relationships that we have, our relationship with work, home, our culture, everything like that. You are making the argument that allowing immigration is going to in some way harm our culture, the what it is to be American.
Well, you kind of misread what I'm saying, which is why I kind of wanted to get through the opening statement. As I was going to say, I'm going to save this from getting into a debate about what is American culture, because I really don't believe that there is any kind of true American culture, a kind that you can be proud of, that exists anymore in the United States. What I was going to say is that as I would define historic American culture, it would be descended from an Anglo tradition. It would be largely focused on a Protestant work ethic, on large social institutions, and a general kind of social capital and a striving for virtue. I think we've gone way off the deep end on a lot of those issues, which is why I don't believe that we have like I said, attractive American culture. I'm sure you can point to certain materialistic things that you could say, this is particularly American. Lots of people do that with hamburgers. I'm not really particularly proud of being identified around hamburgers. So I think that immigration has made it difficult to create an American culture. When we talk about, as I'm sure we will, different groups that exist in the world, we can point to particular things that we ascribe to them. Of course, materialistically, but also in their demeanor and in their societies. Lots of people point to the Japanese on the right side, but you can point to nearly any country in the world and say this is particular to that country. I want to be able to do the same thing. That's where I come at this debate from. I want to be able to be proud of an American culture, but if we stop enforcing certain assimilation standards, I think the most simple of which is language, we're not ever going to be able to identify around a common culture, even if that culture does not yet exist.
Okay, cool. So this is actually, I'm really glad that you brought up this to this right away, because usually when I debate conservatives about immigration, sorry, I'm just moving because I was sitting on the wrong foot. When I debate conservatives about immigration, it always starts out with an argument about economics, whether or not immigration is economically good or is it harmful for America. Usually that's pretty easy to talk about, and then we move on to culture, and now that's where we are now. So we're just skipping over the whole economic argument.
Well, hold on. We're not going to skip over it, but yeah.
All right. I mean, because usually when I debate conservatives, they start with the economic argument, and then they fall back to the culture. So I was curious if we were just skipping right over the natural first step. Yeah, so the reason why a lot of people think, and I don't think you're alone on this, think that there is no American culture that you can point to, like you could to French culture, baguettes and French braids or whatever, right? the reason why we don't have that in that way with America is because, and I know this is a very stereotypical phrase, but America really is a melting pot. America was built upon the influx of immigrants, mostly from Europe. And even back then, especially, there was a lot of racial or ethnic tension between these groups, and they all came together to build America as it is. It's obviously evolved a lot over the last few hundred years, but for the most part, a lot of American culture is sort of like a hodgepodge of the cultures that came here initially and helped build this country and the colonies and whatnot. If you go down to where I live in Southern California, you're going to see a mix of Tex-Mex and Mexican food, Japanese food, Chinese food, Indian food, Thai food. I mean, these are obviously more materialistic things, food, of course, but these are still parts of our culture. When you see these kind of things around, you can see, okay, this culture is present here in America. If you go up to the Northeast, Northeastern, like New York and whatnot, you're going to find a lot of Italian stuff because a lot of Italians live there. And if you go back in time, you'll see that we've treated certain people differently based on their ethnic background when we founded this country. America is very unique from a lot of other countries that have existed and currently exist. I don't think it's fair to compare them in that way. American culture is, well, it's hard to put your fingers on because I'm American. I've lived in America my whole life. I assume you're American as well. We don't really think about what our culture is, do we? If you could really think about it for a while, could you name anything that's really American culture? You could easily name something that's Australian culture, didgeridoos and kangaroos. You could, you know, French fries, I assume, baguettes. We don't really have that here for America because we're a very different country. And I think the reasons that we're different are one of the things that makes America the best country there is.
Well, I guess the question that follows is pretty much what do you see as like an American? What do you believe an American is?
I believe that an American, from the most literal definition, is a citizen of America, someone who lives in America. But if we're talking about the idealistic theory of what America is all about, it's someone who values freedom, someone who values a pursuit of happiness, who upholds some degree of respect for the concepts this country was built upon. Those are the ideas that come to mind.
Okay, so, and this is a very interesting thing because it feels like by those standards, most of the world is just undocumented Americans. And I don't really think that's the case. I think there's a particular kind of society that is bred from particular people. And I think that that's kind of what you point to. I don't believe that you could put anybody in America and have the country turn out the same. And I'm sure you'd agree if you swapped people from say France with everybody in Germany, the societies would be different. And that's not to say that they're better or worse, because I truly don't believe that there's a superiority of certain peoples. But certainly, I don't think you'd disagree that people yield different outcomes, for better or for worse. And so I want to default back to what we were talking about. And actually, the fact that you mentioned the Nation of Immigrants is interesting. You do correctly mention that there was a lot of antagonism towards certain people who were originally in America. That antagonism, I would say, has almost effectively, and I say effectively very intentionally, disappeared. Say, for instance, the Italian people that we were just talking about. More than half of the Italian immigrants that came before 1901 left America. And they didn't leave America because they, you know, thought that, you know, Italy was better. It's because they couldn't assimilate. They were, and you and I both know this. This is why Italian culture is stuck around. It's because Italians are a very proud people. Italians are very culturally rooted. And if they could not particularly tie themselves or kind of submit themselves to that idea of the forging of America, they would usually go back to Italy, because that is where their roots are and that's where they felt more comfortable. I think that way back when we're talking about that nation of immigrants that originally came here, that originally settled with waves of Anglos, Germanic peoples, and the Irish, and then even waves of Chinese immigration, there were a lot more pressures for those people to assimilate to the idea of America. And that idea of America was a lot more specific and was a lot more set in stone than just, well, if you want the pursuit of freedom and pursuit of happiness and you value freedom, you should just come around and hang out. And I think that once we abandon those assimilation standards, you stop having a realistic or a tangible nation.
So we don't, I don't really think we have standards for assimilation in the way that you're making it out to be. I think for the most part, the most people here in America don't really care if someone new comes in as long as they do it legally and aren't hurting anybody. I really don't think that most people in America are that upset or that disrupted or that disenfranchised with their country because you've got people from a different culture coming in, as long as they're not hurting them or bothering them in any way. If we go back in time far enough, I don't think there was like this hard, rigid line of how you need to conform in order to meet the criteria for being an American back in the days of the colonies. Initially, it was just, let's get a shit. There's a new continent that has been discovered. It's got all sorts of new opportunity. Let's go over there and start establishing colonies. I mean, if we go back to much of the land that is currently owned by America, it was owned by the crown or it was owned by France. It was split up. There was wars that happened. There. We had the Seven Years' War between the French and the British. We had the Revolutionary War in which the French helped us beat the British. That was the revenge right there. Mostly, it seems like an American identity back in the day of the colonies was, I'm a frontiersman. I've traveled across the Atlantic Ocean, maybe even the Pacific a little later on. I've come to this new land, and I want to make a new life for myself here. And it was that budding ambition alongside with the Enlightenment that led to the conditions in which America seems to have founded its ideals. And around the same time, we've noticed many other countries, maybe not as extremely as America, but to a similar degree, adopt very similar ideals. And you mentioned this earlier. Germany, for the most part, has a lot of the same freedoms as we do here. They're not as big as on guns, and they're not free speech absolutists like we are here in America. But for the most part, if you take an American and you have them live in Germany for a year, besides the language, they're as far as their rights go, they're probably not going to experience much difference. These Enlightenment ideals have been extremely popular and adopted, not just by America, but by many other countries more recently. And I think that's why you're kind of spurred up a little bit when I mentioned freedom and pursuit of happiness as an American ideal. And you said, but there's so many other countries that do that. And that's part of why we've had an influence on the rest of the world, as have the Enlightenment ideals we were founded on.
Well, then I think that this is just really quickly just going into a complete global phenomenon. I don't know if particularly, like, you said that you were a liberal or a sock then, so I don't believe mm-hmm. you ascribe to, like, the notion of, like, borderless states, right? Or rather, no states at all.
I mean, in an ideal fairy tale world, millions of years in the future, where humanity is beyond anything we're even close to now, maybe we can have a perfectly united world with no nations, no borders, nothing like that. But as a practical solution to problems that we face right now, I think an expansion and improvement of our immigration system is probably the best way to solve these problems. I think as our world currently stands, if we were to just abolish borders and countries, we would fall apart and probably be fucked.
I agree with you there. But then what you're saying is that since the foundation of the United States, lots of countries have become effectively like the United States. I don't believe that's the case. I think that there is a lot more that you would feel out of place with besides language. Within language, there's even particular, you know, accents. There's particular, you know,
dialects.
Dialects. I mean, we say Finna in certain parts of this country. It's soda versus pop. There's all kinds of things that you would feel out of place with, even just within mm-hmm. language. But it goes down to architecture. It is even within the kind of context or the feeling of the nation. I mean, I go to Germany a lot because I have family over there. And when I'm there, I feel out of place. I mean, all the kids smoke cigarettes. They're more accustomed to the weather. There's certain things that they like to do more than people in the United States like to do. So I think there's a lot more to what makes a society different or makes a country different. But if we were to agree with your reasoning that all the countries have become like the United States, I guess we've all just become global citizens. We're effectively undocumented global citizens.
I think many first world countries that you could bring up to mind have pretty similar, a lot of similarities to America. A lot of the ideals that we value here in America are at least somewhat met in a lot of first world countries you're going to find. I mean, if you go over the border from America to Canada, don't get me wrong. I love America. I like our freedoms. I prefer America over Canada. Those goddamn Canucks can go suck the maple syrup from the sweet tit of the mother tree for all I care. But most of the rights that you're going to have, most of the ideals you're going to find, if you cross the border into Canada from America, unless you're going into Quebec or something, you're not going to tell that much of a difference, besides maybe an accent. Same thing goes for if you go to somewhere like France. For the most part, we seem to value very similar things. We generally want to do good or have freedoms in pursuit of happiness. I think these are just basic ideals that came about through the Enlightenment that many very successful countries nowadays have followed through on as a decent model for a society.
Well, see, I don't know if that's correct, and I think French people would beg to differ. I think if you are an American, and they can sniff out Americans, even if there's a common language, European people particularly...
Oh. The hell? Wait, hold on. Can you hear me right now? You can hear me? Okay, weird. I can't hear anything. Like, everything changed for a second, and then you went quiet. I think someone else joined the call. Here, let me try leaving and rejoining really fast. I'll be right back. I don't know what the deal is with that. Don't know why that happened. Here, let me rejoin.
Come
Todd,
on, Todd.
It's always Todd. It's always Todd. Yeah, I'm sorry, Todd.
Yeah, sorry. To catch you up, we were just all ganging up on Todd, who ruined our fantastic dialogue. No, it's all right. But
I don't know why it cuts my audio when someone new joins.
Yeah,
that was weird.
And it doesn't happen.
If he gets kicked off again, we're going to leave him backstage. So.
Politically Provoked has some bias towards the right wing, I suppose.
True. But, this is left-wing censorship. they're finally dishing it out to us left.
No problem. So basically, French people sniff out Americans, and they can tell there's a persona about it. The way that you've lived in America is not the way that you can go and live in France or in any other part of Europe.
What do you mean by that? Wait, can you be more specific? How can you what is different living in America than living in France? Obviously, there's examples of certain lifestyles that would be quite different. Like if you're like sort of a Southern hog that likes to have a lot of guns and, you know, you want to live out in the country and be able to shoot your guns freely, maybe then you can't have that kind of life over in France. I don't know what France's gun laws are, but I'm going to guess those surrendering cowards don't really like guns. I mean, for the most part, the average American lives in a city. That's where we have the highest population density. So many Americans do live in cities. They live in areas that are usually highly educated. If they're in a city, people in cities tend to have a higher education. They're usually within close proximity to certain things like stores, restaurants, etc. So if you took somebody who is living in, let's say, Los Angeles, and you dropped them, assuming they could speak French, dropped them into Paris and gave them a place to live, do you really think, besides being in a new place, that their life is going to be all that different? They're still going to be able to go get the things that they like. Maybe they'll try new foods. I feel like for the most part, your life is going to be mostly the same. It's why people travel. It's kind of an adjustment, but it's not this different planet that you seem making it out to be. I've also noticed, and I don't want to act like I'm bad faith here or anything, but I'm noticing you're making a lot of descriptive statements. As in, this is how things are, is what you're trying to claim. And we can argue over that all day, but I've noticed you've yet to make a prescriptive statement. You've yet to make a statement that because of these points that I'm trying to make, this is why immigration is bad. Mm-hmm. And I really want to hear that argument.
Yeah, sure thing. So I've not heard of anybody who has gone to a different country because they feel it is adequately the same as the country they're from. I think that's kind of a laughable proposal. I don't think people go places and expect them to be the same. In fact, the difference of them makes them more attractive. Of course, there's also economics. That's a reason for much of immigration. But the reason people travel is ultimately just because places are different and things are unique. And the uniqueness of these homogeneic cultures are attractive to people. And what I was saying kind of in the beginning, and by the way, I'm not going to make a terribly prescriptive thing here because it really is a difference of worldview, but I'm making the appeal to the audience that if we really are defined as a nation of immigrants, if that's really what our culture is, I don't really feel proud of being told that my culture is that I have less genuine or gentrified or Americanized versions of cultures from everywhere else. I've said it before. I mean, I don't think I'm going to go to Panda Express because I want to experience, you know, like Asian culture in the United States. And I'm not proud of the United States just because I have Panda Express, right? And I've already kind of explained how there's a materialism that I want to get away with. There's kind of a greater culture. But we kind of skipped over something. This is how we'll get to the more prescriptive.
Hold on, now I have to ask. I have to beg the question. If we're not talking about material stuff like restaurants, the you know, the foods that people bring over and whatnot. What do you mean by culture then?
Yeah.
What's the difference between like Chinese culture and American culture in this regard, for example?
Well, it kind of goes into what I was talking about before, which is that idea of social capital. People in China have developed certain mannerisms, certain customs. They eat at certain times. They may have traditions around eating. They may have certain cultural reasons to interact with people the way they do. There could be a certain way to express that you're discontent with somebody. There's certain taboos that exist in certain societies. And these are all a downstream, not of the material nature, but of the persons that exist in that society. It's the way those persons interact. And it's also the way that those persons develop their society. And that is why we have these large differences between nations and between cultures and societies, is because people are ultimately different and they create different societies outside of the material aspects of that society, like, say, food or music, right? But even music, right, is the expression of a particular group of people. I don't think anybody would say that, you know, hip hop and its foundations in America is not an expression of that group of people in America. I don't think anybody would disagree with that. So to get back kind of to the beginning, which is that we don't really have the same standards to make people assimilate, or you made the claim, and correct me if I'm wrong, because I'm just kind of rehashing what we've gone over. You made the claim that people are not super actually like mad that people move in that don't talk the way they do or who are from a different country. Did you make that claim?
My position is that I think most people here in America are pretty libertarian leaning in regards to what people do. You've got people who are really interested in like, oh, I really don't want immigration. And I imagine you're probably on that train. But I think the average American, for the most part, doesn't give a fuck what anybody else does as long as it doesn't affect them negatively. And they're fine with people coming in as long as they're doing it legally. They're all for legal immigration. And as long as people are, you know, not committing crime and they're getting a job and not leeching off of welfare or whatever, you know, list thing you could list, then I don't think most Americans really care if new people are coming in.
Do you think that was historically the case?
Historically the case? You need to be more specific.
Yeah, like, do you think, kind of in the claim I originally made, that there was a larger air of, like, a pressure to assimilate? I mean, that's the idea of nativism.
If we're going back to, like, the 1920s, I know the Irish were heavily mistreated along with the Italians. I know this because my great-grandma came here to America from Ellis Island, as did my great-grandfather, and my grandma was Italian, or my great-grandma was Italian, and my great-grandfather was Irish, and my grandfather was an Irish orphan in New York City in the 20s. So that was... I've heard a lot of stories about what things were like back then. You know, they had the signs up that said no, can't
Irish,
say
Irish
N words allowed.
Irish
need not apply. You know, only whites. Mm-hmm. Irish need not apply. They called Irish people inside out N words and whatnot.
I mean, Benjamin Franklin called them. He called Germans a swarthy race. So mm-hmm. I think we agree on that.
So there's a but have you noticed there's a similarity there, right, to what's going on now? A lot of Americans today. Granted, I don't think most Americans are like this. Just like I think back then, most Americans, maybe they didn't like Irish people, but they were living wherever in the colonies, and they didn't really care if Irish people were coming in as much because they probably didn't interact with them. Things were very different when America was colonies. Mm-hmm. But back then, there was a lot of animosity for certain ethnic groups. There was a lot of infighting, even here in America, in our budding, beautiful baby of a country back then. That almost seems analogous to the way that we've been treating people from South America, Mexico, and Central America coming here for a while now. And yet today, you don't really meet a lot of German people, like German-descendant people here in America, who are like, those goddamn Italian-Americans, they're disgusting and sweaty. Like, you don't really hear that kind of vitriolic racism. And that's because, despite the fact that there may have been some cultural and ethnic differences early on, despite that, it got worked through. Mm. Generations have passed, and those people who all, like, hated each other to start out with ended up building the best country on the planet. And I think that when we look back at our history, it becomes clear we should not be trying to dig up all this animosity for immigrants coming into this country when that same animosity is what very well could have held us back in the day. And if we didn't work through it, maybe we wouldn't be here today. Maybe America would be split into six countries, a French America, North America, a Canadian one, I don't know, a German one, yeah. An Irish one. Like, who knows what America could look like now?
I actually want to build off that because you've kind of framed this like perfectly, and I want to build off of it. Basically, I pretty much agree with what you're saying, except I don't think it was a bad thing. I think that despite the nativism, despite the massive pressures, the even in some cases like vitriolic racism that people had in their hearts for the swarthy race of Germans coming in, they ultimately did so because they felt that they were already part of the American nation. I mean, this is when we have waves of immigration. The two waves of immigrants before must have done something to stop attacking each other. And that is because they identified around the label of American. They had that idea of American that ultimately bound them together. They had what at the time was a closer cultural tie. I'm going to go on for just another minute because I think this is really important to flesh out. So basically the nativism, the pressures then were what caused those half of Italians to go back to Italy. If I could ask a question, it would be, what if not the pressure that was put on incoming immigrants stopped them from just settling down and acting exactly as they did in their prior countries? Which, of course, you know, I don't think you and I want that to be the case. You wouldn't have somebody walk into your home and then say, I'm going to do everything the way that I've been doing it forever. You would ask them to apply some customs and to try and be a member of the household, right?
Okay, so I don't like that comparison. I guess now we're really getting to the core of the argument. So do you think it's comparable when you have an immigrant who's got... the immigrant could come from any country. It's not America. They've got their own culture. They've got their own ideals. They've got their own thing, and they come here to America. What standards do you hold them to specifically in order to assimilate here? I think for the most part, as long as you're not committing crimes, you're not breaking the law, and you're not fucking with people, regardless of how you practice your own culture in your home and with your friends and wherever you go, as long as you're not getting in other people's way, most Americans don't care. And I think that's one of the greatest things about America is that we have this freedom. A big part of why this country was founded initially was in order to escape the tyranny of authoritarian governments that want to narrow you down into a way you need to act, who you need to worship, what you need to do. I feel like the standards you're setting for assimilation are almost anti-American.
I think that the most basic one that we can point to is language assimilation. And the problem is... Sure. Oh, okay, sorry. You just said sure, right?
Yeah.
Okay, perfect. Yeah, so I think language assimilation is really important. But I think what we're seeing is that there's more and more of a kind of, well, you know, I'll speak English, but that's not really my language. And that's what we see a lot. Is that the, okay, I guess I will be in America and I'm an American in that sense. That idea of civic nationalism is starting to take over the minds of people to the point where they don't see themselves as American past maybe like a passport that they may have, which is why in certain cities in this country, we have even seen the recognition of Mexican national holidays. That's not even the United States. And I think that's one of the most blaring examples because the United States in some cities is starting to recognize the national holidays of countries that are not our own. As a nation, I think that's laughable. But not only that, people are not speaking English within their homes, which means that within their homes, they don't view themselves really as Americans. They see themselves as however they were before.
Is English an American language?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
We invented English?
No. We took English and we made that the language of the country, which is why in, I think it's 37 of the states, there are laws that say English, I think in Missouri, actually, it's very very pointly or very poignantly put, it's that...
Hold on. Okay. We obviously speak English most commonly here in America, but if you're talking about people speaking a language they're more familiar with, probably a language they were born, like that they were raised learning at home when they're not out in public where they don't need to speak English for people to be able to understand them, you think them speaking the language they're most familiar with because it's the language of where they came from is them viewing themselves as not being American? I have no doubt in my mind that perhaps many first-generation immigrants see their identity more tied with their home country than they do the country they now live in. Very similar to, I guess if we want to use a house analogy, you never feel quite at home right after you move to a new place, but as a little time passes, you couldn't imagine yourself living anywhere else. At least that's how my brain tends to work. And I think that's going to obviously be a thing for anybody, no matter where they move. I moved from Florida to California a year ago. I'm still not used to being out here. People talk differently out here. They talk faster and they talk louder and they've got different phrases and sayings. I mean, it's very different, okay? Florida and California, worlds apart, all right?
Wait, hold on. Just to keep you on that point, you've made that comparison to Florida and California. Do you extend that same difference to other countries?
Yeah, sure. Okay. It's a different place.
Well, that
doesn't mean that assimilation is impossible or that assimilation is even necessary by the standard you've set.
That's not quite
right. You've yet to make a prescriptive argument yet. I haven't heard one.
Well,
like, why do you think that immigration is a problem?
Mm-hmm. So I just want to make sure, because earlier you were saying that you would feel practically, as far as the cultural customs or like besides the language, you wouldn't feel totally out of place in a place like France. But it sounds like this is a bit of a different argument, that you even feel out of place in Florida as opposed to California. So I think that that extension would be put to other countries. So I'm just making sure that we can stack up the two things you've said, because I think that is a different argument than what you were saying before. And I want to get into the prescriptive about why I think immigration is bad. So I'll tie this up a little bit as far as what I believe the American culture should be. Like I said before, I don't think an American culture exists, but it certainly will never exist in an identifiable fashion, the way you could point to any other country's culture.
I'm actually really curious, really quickly, before we get into why immigration is bad, I'm actually really curious. Why does it matter that there is an American culture? Let's say there is, let's say there isn't. You've been bringing up that we need to have an American culture, and it seems like it's very important to you.
Mm-hmm.
Why is that important to you, that there is American culture? Mm-hmm. Why do you care that much about the culture of your country? I care about my ideals, and I care about what I care about specifically, but I'm perhaps a little bit more libertarian on I don't care what anybody believes as long as it's not harming me. Mm-hmm. Even your beliefs, I know we greatly disagree. As long as you weren't enacting your beliefs in a way that would affect other people, I wouldn't care.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm really curious why culture matters so much to you.
Well, I think that it's interesting because a lot of people, like I've mentioned before, point to different countries with distinguishable features. And the reason for that is because those features are important. They're identifying, and in many ways, they are excellent. Different parts of different countries and their cultural composition are excellent. And that's what I want
from
the
United
States.
What does that mean, though? Wait, why is that excellent? What does that mean?
No, okay. So when I want to make sure that I'm not just like explaining this as redundantly or circularly as possible.
Are you talking about like architecture? Like people, I mean, obviously, if I want to see insert type of architecture, I might go to London or I might go to Berlin, Germany, if I want to see another type, things like that, of course, right? I might go to Rome if I want to see some Roman architecture. Like that's one thing, but you're like, and these are like things you might go to visit, and these are like identifiable things about these places, but I don't know why you're acting as though if you take a Roman, an Italian who lives in Rome, and you take them over to America, that there's this huge difference in the type of person they are, and they're going to have this really hard time assimilating. If you take someone from Mexico and bring them to America, the fact that they still speak Spanish when they're at home with their family, how does that make them less American?
Oh, dang it. You saying like certain words is starting to refresh my memory on things I wish I would have said. So after I finish what I'm about to say, please just say Spanish in the home so I don't forget. Okay, so basically, what is the way that we distinguish things, that we distinguish anything in the world? It's that we have something to compare it to. We have a thing that is not like that thing. And by those differences, we begin to distinguish them. If you point out anything, whether good or bad, you are pointing it out as different from something. And there are certain features which make that thing particular or individually identifiable. Now, there are certainly things that are not good that you can identify around. I mean, America and certain parts of the country has a sky-high rate of violence. I wouldn't want to identify about that or around that. There's lots of, for instance, in Palestine and Israel, there's huge conflicts that exist between the regions that I'm sure not like many people in those regions don't want to identify around. But the same can be said for good things. The same can be said, you know, for instance, the Protestant work ethic coming out of the English common law, or rather the foundation of the nation coming out of English common law, coming out of the history that the English culture has created, or rather the England is a country. The things that we distinguish it by, the traditions it's had, and the values.
I gotta stop you. I'm sorry. I've heard these talking points many times before, and I'm trying to be as good faith as I can possibly be, but I'm seeing through what you're doing right now. You're using a lot of language that's supposed to be very soft. We're talking about cultures and identifying with something and, you know, recognizing differences and everything. But at the end of the day, you're trying to make a very, very, very radical argument that immigration is bad and we need to stop it. And you need to prove to me that that is the case. You are bringing up the argument that cultures are different, and that's completely fine. That does not mean some cultures are bad and some aren't. If you've got people coming in that want to burn women, I don't know, maybe they're from Saudi Arabia and they hate gay people and they want to burn women if they cheat on their husband or whatever. I don't want those people coming in if that's what they believe, if it's like individuals. But if what is the point that you're trying to bring up here? You're just basically trying to hammer home people are different.
Not just that. I was trying to, and I actually appreciate you interrupting me because I get a little bit long-winded on the explanation. The most simple way I can say that is in the way that we distinguish bad things, we also distinguish good things. And good nations can create good people, and those good people can hold good values that the nation itself espouses. For instance, in China, you may have parts of Confucian tenets that people live in their own lives, or they see those values as integral to their person. So in the way that we might point to the Confucian tradition in China, I want to be able to point to something in America and say that this is distinctly American. We have created a good culture. Culture, the things that a civilization yields, are things that they can be identified around. And I don't think that there should be any argument as to why we should want to create good things, as to why we should want to put good into the world. And what I see right now, what I see right now,
vague.
No. What I see right now is that the country is being defined by the good things about everybody else, not about this country, but about the things that are good about the people who have the cultures of the countries that they're from.
Okay. So what I need from you right now is, here, I'll give you an example. Immigration from Mexico. Obviously, a lot of immigrants from South America and Central America come up through Mexico. Let's just use that as an entire umbrella for immigration coming in right now. Do you have a problem with that?
Like all immigration, or just like from
Mexico?
Do
you have a problem with immigrants coming in through Mexico, both legally and illegally? Do you have a problem with that?
Yes.
Okay. Why do you have a problem with specifically them coming in? Just as one example, what about their culture do you have issue with? What about them coming over do you have issue with? Go into detail.
And just to be sure, you're applying this only to Mexican immigrants?
Only to Mexican immigrants coming up through the southern border.
Perfect. So Mexican immigrants, legally or illegally, like anywhere else in the world, have a culture that is distinct. And if the United States itself has no pressures to assimilate, they will remain completely identifiable by the culture of their home country. I don't believe that a nation is a place for people to come into and then exist as they are. I believe that the nation, this country, should have a transformative effect. Because it goes back to what I'm saying at the beginning. I think it's kind of lame to identify your country by the things from another country, right? Like, that's if we were to say to a Mexican
immigrant. Why does that matter to you? Why can't America be a hodgepodge of different cultures that have sort of amalgamated and been changed as they go? I mean, even if we talk about bits of other nations' cultures that are here, they have been Americanized. If you go over to Japan and you get yourself some sushi, it is not going to be like the sushi you're going to get at a Japanese restaurant here in America. All the things have been changed for the American palate when it comes to food. People behave differently, even if it's a derivative of the culture from where their parents or they came from. Things get Americanized when they come over here.
Do you think
the way that a lot of people talk about it other countries, hold on really quickly, the way a lot of people talk about like their type of food or their type of culture in America when you go to their home country is the Americanized version of what they believe. They don't even see it as their culture because America and the people here have sort of changed it to be more fitting for what we seem to like based on our own preferences and demographic inclinations.
Mm-hmm. And you're kind of making my argument for me. Do you think the Americanizing effect is good?
I don't think it's good or bad. It's completely neutral.
I disagree. I think that, and Italians would say the same thing. They don't really like American versions of their food because they see it as less honest versions of their own culture. I think, like I said in my opening statement, what we have in this country are less honest versions of the cultures that people won't give up. So I would rather not be identified around the less honest or less genuine versions of cultures from other countries. I would rather have my culture, or I would actually, let me rephrase that. I would rather have a culture that I can point to, which is not just taking things that already exist and saying, well, you know, we're going to make sushi into a burrito, which, by the way, is yielding again to the materialistic thing that I'm trying to get away from. It seems that the only way that we can quantify or calculate or even qualify this in the
debate. The reason why people bring up materialistic things when it comes to culture is because it's
just
tangible.
Like making food different, right? Which I think is stupid.
So the reason why people like to bring up food when it comes to culture is because it's something that's tangible. A lot of people like to bring up values. I would say a lot of people more in your area of the political spectrum like to bring up values when it comes to culture, but that's not tangible and that's not consistent. Not everybody, you know, if you go to any country and you ask everybody on the street what their opinions are on X amount of issues, they aren't going to have the same opinion. So what I'm curious about right now is, why do you have a problem with, do you have an issue with like Japanese restaurants being a thing here, Mexican restaurants being a thing here? Is that part of the problem that you think America has?
No, I wouldn't say that I'm particularly like proud, or I don't identify around it.
You describe them as being a dishonest version of the cultures from which those people came from, as though it's a corruption. And not only is it a corruption of the original culture of the nations they came from, but it is also corrupting America, or at least preventing America from having something you can point to as American culture. I'd say that Americanized version of these other places, much like how Americans today are an Americanized version of people from other places generations ago, are part of what makes our American culture a thing. It is a mix, Americanized version of all these different cultures that used to exist, just like us as a people are an Americanized version of people from cultures that existed up to hundreds of years ago, maybe even more recent if you're more recent lower amount of generations immigrant.
Mm-hmm. So I'm going to attack the two points. The first is about like the less genuine version. I think it is a less genuine version. And I think genuine is a better word than like bastardized or than, I think I forget the word that I used before, but you said it in your last bit. So I think it is a less genuine version. I don't think if somebody was given the opportunity to go to or to get sushi, that they would go to America over Japan. I don't think anybody, when they were tasked with getting pasta, would go to America over Italy. And I think that, as you have said, the Americanizing effect on, for instance, food is just that we have like a different, less genuine, less true to original thing that exists somewhere else in the world, most likely better. And I don't want to be the place.
The problem is, if you take an American, if you take an American who loves to eat Japanese food, they like to go to hibachi restaurants and eat sushi, and you drop them in Japan, and you have them eat sushi at a Japanese sushi restaurant, they're probably not going to like what they get handed. A big part of the Americanizing effect on the cultures that that establish some kind of business here and some sort of foothold here to be Americanized are massive. If you try sushi here, you know, it's, you know, you get a little bit of cooked fish, you get it wrapped up in some rice and a little bit of seaweed, you know, a little bit of meat in there, maybe a little bit of wasabi. You go over to Japan, it's doused in vinegar. The fish is raw always. It stinks a little bit. It's very, very different. These things have changed because it has been Americanized. Mm. We've got specific sort of, we've got our own palate here in America, depending on where you live. These things end up changing and assimilating. Even first generation immigrants, when they come here to start a business for like a restaurant, will end up assimilating their food to not even be as much resembling of the culture they came from, more so like here in America.
So the question, I've already kind of made the argument, but so I'll get on to something different. But the closing statement for the food debate, because I really don't want to talk about food. I don't want culture to just be like, we make pasta. So the basic argument is, I think, and I'm going to appeal to the chat, I'm going to ask anybody, if you had the opportunity to take the original of something or the Americanized version of it, which would you take? I would certainly take the thing that is original. It's the original yield of something good to the world that a culture has created. But I want to move on to the point which you were bringing up before, and I've remembered it luckily, which is speaking English at home. Now, the mm-hmm. rates of people speaking English at home have not been the same throughout all of history.
Also, really quickly, I just wanted to really quick to say, the average American chat, you do not want to try Japanese sushi. You will not like it. The sushi you've eaten here in America has gotten you very accustomed to the Americanized version of sushi. This is just one example off the top of my head. I've had actual Japanese sushi before. It tastes like you're eating raw fish in vinegar, okay? It is not good. It is massively different here in America, just for anybody who wants to know.
Actually, let me reframe that question. To the chat, would you be more proud, or would you stand by Americanized sushi, or would you stand by the original sushi if you were
the only claim to pride when it comes to eating is eating a large amount of any food. That's where you get pride from eating, okay? I don't care what culture the food is from. If I will be way more proud of eating a 30-ounce New York steak over a more traditional 10-ounce Texas steak, okay? I think the pride that you get from food comes more from the size and the thing you've conquered than the authenticity to which its culture that it comes from was recreated. I don't know. I don't bind my self-worth so hard to this idea of a culture of my country. I like the ideals that I stand for. I like the ideals that America stereotypically stands for, even. And I get a little bit of a kick out of making fun of other people just because they're not American. You know, Canadians and French people, most notably. You know, like, there's certainly some American pride there, but I don't think there's a culture there that I point to. I mean, even as the closest thing to an American culture that I even talk about are, like, the butts of jokes, like school shootings and and whatnot, you know? Like, what I'm asking right now, what about Mexican culture from Mexican immigrants? One specific thing that harms America, and how? And is it tangible?
Yeah. So, like I said before, I'm going to go to language. Because there is no pressure to assimilate, people remain speaking the languages that they were speaking before, which leads me to believe that they don't see the country as a place to assimilate to a standard. And you kind of agreed that the common language of the United States is English. Mm-hmm. In 38 states, it said so. Missouri's constitution literally says, and if you don't assimilate to the English language, or rather, no, they say assimilation to the English language is necessary to be a productive member of basically their society mm-hmm. or culture. So when people come to this country, and even if they speak English outside mm-hmm. of their home, they choose in many cases, because they can speak both languages. They choose not to speak the English language. What do you think that projects? What attitude do you think it projects?
I think that projects they can speak two languages and they switch between them. Should they just cast off Spanish? No longer speak.
No, I think so.
How's that hurting anybody? I can't believe this is the example that you brought up. I asked you for a tangible example of how Mexican immigrants coming here to America and how they're bringing their culture here is going to hurt America. And your example is, well, they speak Spanish and maybe also English, and sometimes they speak Spanish at home. What idea does that project? I know it doesn't really hurt anybody, and nobody probably even hears it because they're in their house, but you know, that kind of sends a bad message, right? How is that tangible? How is that actually hurting us? What can you point to as, like, see how this is hurting society? There's nothing there.
Okay, so I kind of misread what you meant by tangible. So I think the most tangible effect we can talk about is the economic effect, which we can get to in just a minute. The point I was making here is that it projects very clearly, I don't think anybody can argue with this, that you are choosing not to be or not to change yourself for the country you're in. You choose to remain the way you were before the country. And like
I don't even agree with that. I don't even agree with that. I don't even agree with that descriptive statement. It's not even true. You know, just by living here, hold on really quick. It's a very quick statement. I'm sorry. I have to interject a little bit. I've let you talk quite a bit. I have to say, the people are going to end up being shaped by the country they've moved to, especially here in America, no matter what. It's not so much that there's a hardcore standard set, but that just coming over here sort of naturally, you're going to end up having to learn English, and you're going to learn it because everybody around you is going to be speaking it, and you're going to have to make friends who speak English. You need to be able to speak English to go to a lot of businesses and do things you need to do. You got to go to the DMV. Well, you got to learn English if you want to talk to the lady at the front desk of the DMV, unless she knows Spanish too. Chances are she wants to keep it English, you know? This is just a thing that naturally kind of happens. And especially once those immigrants have children, by the third generation, the vast majority of third generation immigrants here in this country don't even know the language that their grandparents came here to speaking. Mm-hmm. They don't even know the language. They've completely assimilated into English. They don't even know, like, Spanish as an example.
Okay.
And certainly second generation immigrants learn it and tend to to favor English just because it's simpler to do that. But if you're a first generation immigrant and you come here and you still speak your native language at home, this isn't a degradation of society. This isn't an example of them not fully embracing being an American. They're here for a reason. They seem to appreciate something about America. They seem to have some value in living here. Why would them speaking the language they're most familiar with at home, not even out in public where it would get in anybody's way or no one would be able to understand them, how is that harming America?
Okay, so that was a really long thing. And I think a lot of it, as far as, you know, the actual reality of the United States is incorrect. I don't think you can make the argument that the United States requires you to learn English in many parts of the country. Every time that you pick up a phone, you hear "Press two para español." Every time you hop on a bus in a major city, which is, by the way, where most of these immigrants are, you're going to hear the instructions in Spanish. In certain places, speaking Spanish is kind of a prerequisite to getting a job. The DMV has everything else in Spanish. Nearly every single government form you pick up has the opposite side in Spanish. Even in my school in Utah, the opposite of any paper that I had was in Spanish. And I'm in Utah. There's like less than a 10%.
Wait, are you a Mormon?
I am. Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
Anyway, I'm going to get back to the point.
I heard you say you're from Utah, and I was like, oh, you're a Mormon. I got you.
I got to give you credit. Most people like know that I'm Mormon, or they know that I'm from Utah, and they don't deduce that the right-leaning, family-oriented conservative is also Mormon, which I don't know how they don't get that. But anyway.
Wait, really quick. I'm curious. Is soaking real?
No. Okay. Hold on. This is important. Soaking is a psyop to get young members of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints to have sex. If you soak, you've had sex and you need to repent. That's my two cents.
From my understanding, soaking is a loophole.
God doesn't know if the guy doesn't move. It's a psyop. But how would God know?
Like, what if you're just, you know, wrestling or something? You're just sitting there. You're not going in and out.
Okay.
You know?
We could have soaking discourse in a different debate.
But that would be an example of you know, there's an example of like culture of some kind.
Yeah,
it's something.
I don't know if I want to identify around the culture of soaking, which I still don't believe is real. I've been in the church 18 years, and I almost fell out, but it wasn't because I found out about soaking, because I don't think it's real. Anyway, so the point that I was making is that nearly every single federal document, which I think is the best thing to point to because it's like the actual government, has instructions in Spanish, to the point where it's not just about saying, hey, we're going to be accommodating the people who might not know their way around. It's literally, you can live in our society and you don't need to assimilate to the language. And in certain cases, like I mentioned, if you don't speak Spanish, it will even be a detriment to you.
So sure, we have different things in our society, especially in larger cities. I mean, I live in Southern California. I don't live that far away from LA and San Diego. So of course I see things like, and I used to live in Florida, where we've got a lot of Cuban immigrants, which, by the way, let's just say the Cuban immigrants are a big reason why Florida is such a hard red state. Those Cuban immigrants vote very conservative. Thought that'd be worth bringing up, considering there's sort of a underlying idea behind this debate that perhaps the values of those coming over may not be in line with that of America. We have certain things like signs, and certain businesses will certainly accommodate for people who may speak Spanish, for example, if you're here in like Southern California. But for the most part, beyond that, beyond just a few little stepping stones for people who perhaps haven't learned English yet or prefer Spanish, you're gonna have to learn English eventually. There's just, the data and the stats are just there. By the second generation, and even the first generation, the native language that immigrants speak just kind of falls to the wayside, and they end up learning English and speaking that primarily even at home. By the third generation, they don't. This is born in stats. I can link them to you if you'd like through Discord.
Okay.
If you
want to add me on Discord, then I'm gonna ask for it. Then I do want a link to the rates at which people speak Spanish versus English in their own homes. And if you can find a measure over time, that would be even better, because the statistics around this do show that over time, more people are now speaking Spanish within the home. I will agree with you that people assimilate to the language. But I think, like I said before, the language they choose to speak in their home is more reflective of the attitude they have towards the country, which is that when I'm in my own home, I don't really see myself as an English-speaking American.
Cool. Yeah. So this is from the Cato Institute, cato.org/publications/immigration-research-policy-brief. And this is on language. While immigrant region of origin has shifted, age has not changed nearly as much. Table 2 shows that immigrants are still predominantly of working age. They come in around like the teens or whatnot most commonly. And as for English acquisition, in 2010, 90.98% of immigrants specifically from South America and Mexico know English and speak it regularly.
Wait, which generation of immigrants?
This is 19. So the vast majority are, because this is of all of the immigrants coming over, this is the split up.
Just send me the link. It's kind of more difficult to ask the question over.
Do you want to add me? Is there a chat?
Yeah, we have a private chat on the side.
Also, I think I added you on Discord and you just haven't added me back yet, which kind of hurts.
Rude, Sanderhoff.
Oh, I apologize for that. Here,
do you see the private chat?
No, I don't see. I'm just going to DM it to him on Discord.
Okay.
Could you message me really quick? Just a DM?
Sure thing.
Yeah. So this link breaks down the age demographics of people coming in and the percentage of Mexican immigrants that have come into America that know English. So yeah, if you send me a message.
I still don't see. Well, you haven't added me back, so I don't think it's going to go through.
I don't see you in my pending.
What the?
Try sending a friend request, and I'll press the little.
How do I unsend my first one?
you right click and you click add as friend on my name.
Okay, perfect.
There you are. All righty. So here you go, cato.org. There you go.
All right, perfect.
Scroll down about a third of the way, and it'll show you the breakup between regions, the age demographics of those coming over, and their English. English. Yeah, even I, born and raised in America, can't even speak English properly.
Wait, so did you say it was 99% learned English?
90.98.
Okay. 90.98. Okay. Sorry. Yeah. I heard you said 99. My bad. Okay. So no, that's plausible. Still though, I mean, if I'm not wrong in what you've said, the age of the people who are immigrating is like in their teens, their working age, right? Mm-hmm. And then 10% of them, nearly 10% of the people who come to the United States around their teenage years, never learn the English language. You have like 60
not in
years.
The time, not at the time that the study was done. If you look at the data here, you can see that in 1900, it was only 89% of people who came over knew English, probably because a lot of them were from Europe. So 89% is pretty reasonable. You've gotten 1910, only 77%, 1920, 86, 1930, 91, 1980, 92, 2000, 89, and now 2010, it's at an all-time high. Mm-hmm. Well, do you think that perhaps having this like this demographic of young, working age, hardworking, English speaking immigrants that are helping the economy? Because, of course, workers are a resource. And we know what happens. Look at Japan. We know what happens when you cut off immigration and you cut off a sort of steady stream of people who are willing to come in and work and contribute to society. It seems like, I'm becoming even more steadfast in my belief here.
Well, I think it's very interesting that you mentioned the rate or the rates over time and like in the past, how people also haven't learned English. I don't think that's good. I would never make the argument that over time, people not knowing English has ever been good. I think 10% of people who don't know English is too high. I think at the minimum, and we should be able to compromise on this, at the minimum, a prerequisite to immigration should be language fluency. Would you agree with that?
Legal immigration?
Yes.
What do you mean by language fluency? I mean, you can come into the country and do fine and learn the language. I mean, 10% of, by the way, 90% of a group of people coming in knowing the language, that is very high. And language isn't like, oh, you are born and you're born unable to learn this language. Obviously, that 10% can also learn the language. Okay. Even if they don't, that's a punily small amount of people
okay.
who don't know the
hold
language
on, hold
coming
on.
In.
Xander Hall, that's not quite accurate. I think a lot of the way that people frame this is the idea that all immigrants settle in one spot, or rather settle across the country, that they're evenly dispersed. That's simply not the case. I think it's like most of immigrants settle in only 29 cities in the entire country. So if you have millions of immigrants over time, and we're looking at your statistics, you have more than a million people in this country settled in these small and particular areas who don't know the English language. Now, I'm not arguing that 90% is not big. And by the way, I think it's good that the these Mexican immigrants are learning English at higher rates than before. But
well,
I would
think part of it
argue...
is because even in Mexico, you have to know English because you get so much American or English speaking tourism there. It's almost mm-hmm. become like the opposite thing that the thing you're trying to argue now is happening to America is more so, if anything, happening over in Mexico. And even then, I don't think it's almost
in
a
Mexico,
prerequisite. If you're a Mexican citizen, you need to learn English.
I don't think anybody in Mexico is speaking English in their home. I don't think
perhaps not, but to be an out in public, English is something that if you're a Mexican citizen, you are a great advantage, even if you plan to live in Mexico for as long as you live, to be able mm-hmm. to speak English, especially up by the border in areas like Tijuana and Mexico City.
And I don't think that's the case. I mean, as far as, or rather, I don't think that should be the case. I think as far as tourism goes, certainly, like, you're going to benefit by learning a different language. But in this country, like, if you work in a McDonald's that's close to the border, you are, like, going to be seen if you can speak Spanish or not. Like, these are prerequisites that people look for that they shouldn't be looking for. We are an English-speaking country. We have always been an English-speaking country. Even when Germans and Italians came over, they had to assimilate to the English language. And that should be the case for every single group of immigrants. Now,
do you believe immersion doesn't result in assimilation when it comes to language? Because that seems to be the best way to learn it.
The whole
isn't it like a meme that if someone drops you off in a country and you'll find some way to learn the language of that country, like you just have to? Like, I'm pretty sure that's been like a well-studied thing that you could literally drop someone who's only known one language their whole life into a foreign country and they'd be able to learn the language eventually. They'd have to. They'd learn it out of necessity.
Yes. The problem is that I don't believe that Mexicans coming to this country, settling in the cities they settle in, need to learn English. And that's the problem, is that we don't make it so that people need to learn English. I will agree, you could. But why would that matter if when you're back in your home, you continue speaking the language of the country you were in before? It means, or it shows, that you don't see this nation as a particular place to find your identity or to become American. You find it as a place to do work. Maybe there's, you know, a higher wage than in Mexico. So you're just going to settle down, remain as you are, and end up, you know, just doing the job.
So do you think if I plot, what do you do for work? I'm curious. Don't dox yourself if you can't.
No, it's all right. This is going to be really funny, judging from the conversation we've had already. I scoop gelato.
Okay, you were wearing a suit, and I kind of just imagined maybe you did something a bit more corporate. No. I don't know. Let's say you apply for a corporate position at the place that you work for, right? You're looking to get a little bit higher up, maybe to be a manager. Do you think right now, if I took away your ability to speak English and I made it so you could only speak Spanish, do you think you would be able to get that management job at the place that you work or that corporate job at the place that you work? Of course not. You need to learn English. If you are not able to learn English and speak English here in America, there is a very, very, very low ceiling that's going to block you from a significant amount of opportunity. Most of the people coming here to America, if they're willing to take the risk and the hardship of actually immigrating here, whether it be legally or illegally, they're probably here to strive for something better. And that thing they're striving for that's better is going to be very, very hard to achieve if they don't learn English and learn it well.
Okay.
Because most decent jobs and positions in this country are going to require you to know English. Maybe it's better if you know Spanish as well, but you have to know English.
Then I want to take exactly your example. Let's imagine that we're talking about the Hispanic immigration coming from Mexico, and let's also apply basically everything we know about Mexican immigration. Are Mexican immigrants coming to this country to move into managerial positions or corporate positions?
Sorry, no. Repeat that. I was hitting my cloud.
Basically, I'll answer the question. Mexicans who are immigrating to this country are not looking for corporate positions. They're not looking to become ambassadors for any company or become lobbyists or something like that. What they're looking for is labor at a higher wage than their native country, and most of that labor is low education or low skill. That's where the
competition. That's only the case for first-generation immigrants, though. It's not the case for second, third, and onward.
Just well, I'm not making the case for second, third, and onward because I'm not.
Well, a lot of people who come into this country come here with children, or they come here pregnant, or they end up having children once they come here. The immigration topic doesn't just focus on people who are first generation immigrants.
that's you have to be very particular about the way you're saying first generation immigrants, because if you like, if you're born in Mexico and you're brought over with your parents, you're not a first, you are a first generation immigrant. If your parents are already in the country and then they have a child, you're second generation. So you can't just say like you bring a kid over and that kid learns it, because as we've already shown, you know, 10% of the teenage people who come from Mexico to America are not learning English, which is easily more than a million people in this country.
Do you think there's much of a difference between a baby who was born over the border and was brought here as a, as like a baby, and then someone, a baby who was born over on this side of the border? Like, they may be different generations of immigrants, but effectively they're going to have the same experience.
Oh, no. I agree with you, but the statistics, you know, it's very relevant to be very particular about the
also these, you understand that the kids end up going to school and stuff like that. They end up having English-speaking classmates. They're going to learn English.
Uh-huh, but do you realize what's happening in more and more schools?
People are learning Spanish?
No, certainly. Actually, yeah. In many places, in many schools, there's classes that
are
dedicated
to... I took Spanish in high school.
Well, I took it too, but there are literally classes. There are literally schools dedicated to people who don't speak English, or they have the classes in their home language. Which, and look, this is a really convoluted debate that can really easily be summed up in one way. You have so many issues. You need to learn a language. Assuming your worldview is, or what you've told me so far is correct, if you don't know English going into the country, you have occupational issues, you can't, you know, read documents that are all around, you basically have to learn English or you can't thrive in this country. Would not it be easier if you and I just agreed English fluency was a prerequisite to moving to America, so that 10%, no, those millions of people wouldn't be.
You haven't proved to me there's a problem. Everything's fine. Why you're insisting that we fix something? It's not broken.
Okay. Resources dedicated to English as a second language classes in school must number in the millions every year throughout the entire country.
I know what classes you're talking about. They existed at the schools in Florida that I went to, and those classes were specifically for people who'd immigrated in order to learn English, and they learned it quite quickly. And by the end of like the first semester, they'd be back in normal classes because they'll have learned enough English that they can follow along.
But if you know English before you come to the country, resources don't need to be spent on English as a second language.
Yeah, over 90% of them already do know English.
But 10% of them, millions of people in certain places in the United States, not everywhere, not like in Wisconsin, not in Utah, but in particular regions like of Florida, like of California, Texas, and New Mexico, those places are likely spending lots of money, and by the way, the entire country spending lots of money, on these kinds of classes in schools. Those classes would not need to exist if before people came to this country, they spoke English.
So you're not showing me a demonstration of any harm being done.
It's not a particular harm. It is a cost benefit analysis. If we say, okay, you need to know English before you come to the United States, boom, we've erased millions of dollars of school spending, which we've taken off of property
taxes. So naturally, if we're talking cost benefit analysis, naturally it's going to have to lead us to, if we don't agree on the topic of people, of 10% of Mexican immigrants not knowing English coming over as being a problem, if we don't agree on that, then naturally we have to move to the economic side. You're going to have to make an argument to me that we are hurt economically so much by this immigration that it doesn't make it worth it. If you can make that argument to me, then perhaps we'll agree. But on this cultural social aspect, it doesn't seem like you can point to a solid example of immigration harming our culture and our nation.
Sure thing. So let me pull up the economics for you. Firstly, you know, when we're talking about economic assimilation to begin with, we're seeing that economic assimilation is even getting worse. And the statistic there is Borjas's 2018 Lessons from Immigration Economics. I can send it to you if you'd like. I've got an excerpt cut out of which I'm going to read. It says, basically, the assimilation outlook is far less optimistic for recent waves of immigrants, and the earnings of immigrants who arrived in only the late 1990s did not grow at all in their first decade here. So when we're talking about immigrants who are coming to this country, I'm going to affirm what I said before, which is that they are not moving into these corporate sectors. If their children do, that's a different story. But I'm not in the business of waiting 30 years or 20 years or however long it takes for people to have kids, and those kids waiting 10 years till they can speak English fluently or get a corporate job. I don't want to wait 40 years until that business is finally resolved, until the children can finally like speak English or whatever. Right. And by the way, I've kind of breezed over the idea that the people who are in the United States or have immigrated to the United States all have the equal level of English fluency. You and I both know that's not true. especially with older populations, it's incredibly difficult to learn English, and many of them do it far into their lives, if ever.
Sure. So you're making the argument that immigrants that are coming over are seeking low-skilled labor, and that is why they are not helping our economy?
Are we still talking about Mexican immigrants?
Yeah.
Yes.
Sure. So I got... Well, a shit actually, ton of sources. Hold on.
If I can reframe, I don't want to cut you off before you get started.
This is relevant to the example.
No, I know. But I don't want you to debate something that I'm not really framing the right way. So I'll just kind of reframe. I'd say that they have a negative effect, either pushing up on immigrants who are already here. They cause wage stagnation. And many of the problems of immigration are not even covered in most of the data about it. So that's basically where I put it. By the way, I'm not going to only be citing Borjas. I know there's issues with him. I'm not really into the idea of having a debate about Borjas versus anybody else.
Yeah, the main issue is I know I wasn't going to bring up him as an example of a source claiming that we gain a lot economically from immigration, but I do know Borjas specifically, I believe, is pro-immigration. I believe, like, accounting for all of his, all the data he's looked at and everything he's published, he overall has a positive stance on immigration because he believes it has a net positive effect on our economy in the long run. Right now, though, I'm going to cite the National Bureau of Economic Research. They talk about how it's a paper on the effects of immigration has on wages in the United States. Study contends previous analysis on the relationship between immigration and wages falsely assumed perfect labor substitutability between immigrants and native workers of similar education levels, distorting results. Research shows average Americans' wage rises due to immigration, both short-term and long-term. Only native demographic whose wages drop are high school dropouts who suffer a decrease in wages of approximately 2% short-term, alleviating to 1.1% over time. Study finds new immigration does severely impact wages of prior immigrants, suggesting lack of substitutability with natives. Overall, vast majority of American workers' wages increase from immigration, high school dropouts, which are only 10% of the population or less than, experience a slight decrease, which alleviates with time anyway. Mm-hmm. That seems to be the finding, that overall, in the long run, it seems to positively impact our economy and the wages of native workers.
Okay, I'm going to be taking a bit of a dishonest approach. I just want to see if you know the question. Does this study, which I'm familiar, take an occupational or a spatial approach to their research?
I can check. Let's see. Do you want me to link it to you?
I know it. I've got it pulled up.
Okay, then if you have a contention with it, just tell me what the issue is.
All right, so basically, the contention with this study is the contention with most studies in the literature about immigration, which is basically that when they talk about a wage increase, first of all, anybody should, their ears should peek up at that. There's a wage increase when the labor market, which is subject to all of the other rules of supply and demand, like any other market, is flooded with new people. Why are wages increasing if there is more of a supply in labor? Wouldn't that logically mean they go down? Well, the answer is yes. So what's the answer? The answer is found in the body of research, which looks at these issues spatially. What happens when a lot of people immigrate to an area is largely that people leave. A lot of people call this white flight. Other times, you know, people will just look at, or they'll use different names for it. But ultimately, you do have people leaving an area. You have laborers leaving an area. So when there is this kind of net blank effect, you have people leaving, you have people entering, the entering people are immigrants, you're not going to have that significant effect on wages. So the only way you would come away from the study thinking that there's an increase in wages is if you haven't accounted for the people exiting the area. And if you haven't accounted for the people exiting the area, I'm guessing you also haven't accounted for other factors that are economic besides just wages. Wages, which are, by the way, a very small proportion of overall income, an increasingly small proportion of overall income. So, yeah, I'm assuming you haven't looked at housing. I'm assuming you haven't looked at, and by the way, to answer the study, the effect on immigrants themselves is likely because those immigrants who are already working there and are being displaced by other immigrants are not leaving the places which they find the most homogeneity in, because those places probably speak their language and are already welcoming to them as they are.
Yeah, sure. So my response to that is another study done by the University of Pennsylvania that goes over the reasons exactly why it seems that wages have been increasing due to immigration. I'll go ahead and I'll link that to you right now. The overview of it, as I will read off to you, is it's an extensive summary on the effects of immigration has had on the U.S. economy with sources. The available evidence suggests that immigration leads to more innovation, a better educated workforce, greater occupational specialization, better matching of skills with jobs, and higher overall economic productivity. This seems to be the reason why wages are rising, because when you bring in workers, you may be bringing in a resource that you would think, logically speaking, supply and demand, of course, that the more workers you have, the lower wages would get. It seems like there are other extenuating factors that come along with these new workers coming in that results in yet a still long-term beneficial rise in wages nonetheless.
So I'm actually familiar with this study as well, and I have a few other contentions with it. That study, it really doesn't address the idea of a competition for scientific and technical occupations. This is what it brings up later on. It says, quote, less skilled natives often respond to increased competition from immigrants by leaving manual labor for occupations that emphasize language and communication skills. This greater specialization leads to a more efficient allocation of labor, raising the incomes and productivity of both natives and immigrants.
Holy shit, wait, hold on. Are you telling me this the language disparity that we debated earlier resulting in wages going up here in America?
You're not, okay.
Wait.
I would appreciate if you don't cut
me
off.
Damn, immigration's even better now.
I would appreciate if you don't cut me off before I make my point. The point is, one factor that most people don't even talk about whatsoever, which is an unfortunate one, which is automation. Which sectors of the economy do you think automation is going to be affecting?
Most notably, I mean, off the top of my head, transport. So you've got truck drivers and whatnot, and the agricultural industry. And obviously, migrant workers and immigrants do a lot of work there.
Yes.
Unskilled hard labor.
Especially Mexican immigrants. It also is going to start automating away labor that is risky, but particularly low-skill, low-education labor. So when we start to see these sectors being automated, and by the way, there's a McKinsey study that says it's going to be like one-third of all the jobs by 2040. The McKinsey study is very hit or miss with people. There are more conservative estimates that it's going to be upwards of like 30 million jobs. And these kind of estimates are crucial when we're talking about what jobs immigrants go into. Immigrants, like you just said, go into agricultural labor, go into low-skill, low-education labor. They cannot compete, or at least Mexican immigrants who go into these occupations, cannot compete with higher sectors of the economy. So what do you get when automation starts displacing these workers? You get rampant homelessness and you get a huge, huge drain on the welfare system, of which immigrants who are not yet high school educated or are only high school educated are already a fiscal net negative of. And I can cite that study as well. But basically, to sum this all up, you've created the snowball effect where immigrants go into the lower sectors of the economy and start doing jobs that they are easily automated in. And once they're automated, you've created a lot more homeless people. And you've created far more people who are going to be dependent on a welfare state that they don't directly already benefit to. Because they're not paying it in taxes. So that's basically the take there, which is why I don't like when people just say, well, the entrance into low-skill jobs is going to affect everybody positively, because ultimately they'll be displaced.
Sure. Yeah. So it seems as though I'm looking at a study right now from the Cato Institute. I'll link you right now about particularly Mexican immigrants, I believe, their effects and their like an analysis of how much they take and how much they give when it comes to the welfare state. And it appears like immigrants are about half as ever since, at least as far as Medicare and Social Security go. There's obviously cash assistance, SNAP, SSI, and Medicaid, in which immigrants take a little bit more than the native population. But especially with Medicare and Social Security, it seems like immigrants are taking less than or about half of what native-born citizens are. And if you scroll down more, it appears to come to the conclusion that immigrants are not taking more out of the system than they are giving. A big part of this, I imagine, is the fact that a lot of, especially illegal immigrants, have to work under the table, and they don't get to have that money put in for their Social Security and whatnot, and yet they still end up having to pay into taxes. Despite the fact they don't have a Social Security number, they have to pay taxes and property tax if they rent a place. They have to pay taxes for certain things like gas. So they are still putting money into the system. It seems like, as far as the data can tell, they're not taking more of it out than they're putting in.
Okay, the next question is, which immigrants are not taking out more than they're putting in?
I don't know. You tell me.
It is
You've got a retort.
No, yeah. It's the immigrants who already have an education. It's the immigrants who are already high skill. And the study you just mentioned, unless I'm reading it incorrectly, does not just call or does not just look at Mexican immigrants. It's looking at all immigrants. There's plenty of high skill immigrants who do positively provide to the economy of the United States. But those aren't the ones who are being displaced. The ones who are being
the problem, though, is that you're making an argument that immigration is bad, period. You're not talking about having a bit more of a stringent, standard on who we let in.
Well,
you are arguing immigration is bad. That is your position in this debate. You can't bring up, well, it's only this group of immigrants that are actually causing that problem and still concede that the rest of that group are not causing this problem as evidence that immigration is bad. That's just not how it works.
And again, you're getting a little bit cocky before I've brought up that point, because I do have a rebuttal to the higher sectors of the economy, which I'm hoping you'd agree with. But let's just ask a simple question. Would you find my opinion? Well, actually, I want to be very particular. Would you agree to the opinion of more immigration restrictions if we were restricting high skill, which is majority high IQ immigrants, and we were also restricting them to be only English speakers, which, as you agreed, are the people who are doing these high-skilled jobs. Would you agree to that?
That we need to limit our...
Yeah, would you agree to limiting
who are
to
higher
those
IQ?
Populations? Yes.
No, I don't
perfect,
think that we
perfect.
Should have
so,
like a...
So,
a
well, and that's why this is
sort of
this,
like,
that's why this is a redundant
like you have
thing
to like
up.
That sounds a little too close to eugenics for me, right? Like you have to be this smart, must be this smart to enter. You know, it doesn't really sit right with me. I don't
and,
think
well,
that's
and by the way, I'm kind of with you. I think there's plenty of things that stop immigrants from being a positive influence, even if they are super intelligent and even if they yield economics, right? And that's where you know the culture idea of
it just
incompatibility
doesn't seem like that's
comes
torn
up.
Out
well,
the
but
data,
hold on,
though.
But hold on. That's what I was trying to point out, is that you would not agree to decreasing immigration to a, you know, to a higher threshold of workers. You wouldn't agree to that. So what's the point of you bringing up that I am actually more restrictive than I'm letting on, right? So first of all, you're right. I want to restrict all immigration, but you win no points in the argument by saying, well, hold on, you're only restricting it a little bit. Because you don't agree to any restriction whatsoever. You don't agree to the restriction of only high-skill workers. So why would you bring up that point?
As far as immigration restriction goes, I believe that as long as we've got room and we're not seeing any downside borne out in data by letting too many people in, broadly speaking, I'm fine with immigration. It seems like it causes a net positive. It seems like most economists seem to agree. There's a reason why corporations and businesses... Hold on, I'm really curious. Are you a Nick Fuentes fan? Someone mentioned before that you were a Groyper.
Yes, I am a fan of Nick. The
Okay. So if you're a Nazi, then you recognize. Wait. It's fine. Okay. Listen. It's okay. You recognize that there is you seem to believe that there is an agenda by wealthy elites that seem to be in favor of immigration. Yes, I imagine that's an opinion you hold. I know Nicholas Fuentes holds that opinion. Is that an opinion you also hold?
Yeah, I think it's within the interest of people who are in positions of economic influence to import people they can pay less. I think that's certainly the case.
It's not just that they can pay less, because we've seen that wages end up going up. It seems it's because it helps the economy to bring in immigrants. And that's why those that are wealthy want to bring in immigrants. You know this is the case because you use this as an example of how the Jews or whatever in power are manipulating the policymaking into allowing more people in. This is clearly an example. I mean, even by your own standards, your own political, affiliations, it seems as though there is a direct line of evidence that, yes, it does in fact seem to help the economy when we bring in immigrants. You would use that as an example of how the powerful Jews are using this as a way to cuck the white race into letting brown people in.
Yeah, so Xander, first of all, I think what you just did is really surprising. Did you think that I was adjacent to Nick or a fan of Nick's as we were having this debate up until that point?
Probably about halfway into our talk, somebody mentioned that you were a Groyper, and I was like, I mean, he kind of acts like he's a Nick Fuentes fan, but like, I'm going to give him the benefit of the doubt. Mm-hmm. But as you kept on using so much soft language that seemed like you were really trying to skirt around the main point of your beliefs, I decided to ask you, and now that I know that you're a Nicholas Fuentes fan, that sort of cleared the water a little bit on your beliefs. So why do you think we need to have a white America? That's my main concern now, because I know that's what you want to get at. I know that's really the core of the argument you want to have. So now what I'm really curious about is, why do you want America to be white? And why do you want it to be a centralized, identitarian, nationalist, sort of like heavily tied to our ethnicity kind of thing? Well, why is that what you want?
Well, I think this is a really interesting pivot. But I think what's more important to note is that...
It's not a pivot. We're waving through the smoke and we're getting to the core.
No, I think you pivoted right in the middle of the conversation, right in the middle of our discussion of economics, on which I know your sources and have conflicts with your sources, which I've expressed. You said, are you a Nicholas J. Fuentes fan? Had I said no, you would have likely begrudgingly continued the debate. Because I said yes, you can pivot on to calling me a Nazi. You can pivot on to guessing my views. You can pivot on to assuming that I'm into the JQ or whatever else. So because you mentioned that in the middle of the debate for no reason other than to pivot, you are now engaging in this conversation where you can label me a white nationalist, a white supremacist, or anything of the sort.
If you listen to the conversation, you're a fan of a guy who talks about how the Holocaust didn't happen on his stream. It's kind of perhaps a little bit worrying for me. I have a certain amount of responsibility that I have to have if I'm platforming you. I need to make sure that I'm not platforming ideas that are being dishonestly represented. And no. It seems as though the evidence suggests that you are perhaps cloaking your true ideals, your true motivations, and an argument that just doesn't seem to really hold up.
Okay, I've tried to articulate my opinion as clearly as I can. What benefit to whatever Nazistic or white nationalist ideas I may have, what benefit do I provide to them by saying things that are not those things?
That sentence didn't make any sense.
No, it does make sense. What benefit do I provide to the idea of national socialism or white nationalism by debating a thing in a particular way that is not explicitly white nationalist or national socialist? What benefit do they derive from
dog whistling?
I know. I understand the concept of dog whistling.
Self-preservation.
Hold on. I understand the concept of dog whistling, and I understand that concept of self-preservation. But you're arguing that I, by saying things I haven't said, or by saying what's not said, have somehow made an argument in favor of a certain worldview. I have tried to articulate as clearly as possible the worldview I hold, which is, in my own opinion, not white nationalist, not white supremacist. And I've tried to be very clear about why I believe that's the case. I think there are plenty of cultural incompatibilities between the Europe we have today and the America that I'd like to have. I'm sure there are plenty, and I've articulated that through the debate. But on the basis of my association with someone alone, you have claimed or you have said that I've made arguments I haven't made for a thing I don't believe in, which is incredibly dishonest of you.
So maybe if you were just a Nicholas Fuentes fan and you were coming on here and you're making the economic argument and the social argument and your line of logic made any sense whatsoever, maybe then I would be inclined to believe you. But it seems as though that you've cobbled together an argument that does not mention race or does not mention ethnicity as a way to try to avoid getting to the core of your true beliefs and the true motivations behind your desires.
If you're right and I haven't mentioned race, what benefit to racial views of this country is given?
Consequentialism, right? So for example, if you want to, like for me, right? If I was secretly a communist and I came out here pretending to be a Sock Dem, you could claim that I'm a communist pretending to be a Sock Dem, and I'd be like, well, okay, I mean, maybe that's something that would make sense. Would it not still be beneficial to a communist agenda if I came on here and argued for policies that would help improve the country? Because from my perspective, you could argue that me pretending to be a Sock Dem and advocating for progressive policies is a way of trying to support my secret communist leanings, and that would follow through with you, of course. You may be a Nazi deep down, but you use more soft conservative white nationalist arguments in favor of cutting down on immigration, the same thing that Nazis want. You just use the different arguments, different lines of logic that don't make sense.
So Xanderhal, if I convince people of a conservative position and I don't mention race, at what point do you think I'll convince them to become racial, like, or rather white nationalists? At what point do you think by saying that I'm not a white nationalist and I don't support white nationalism because I think there are cultural compatibilities or incompatibilities among white people, do you believe I am making people white nationalists?
Oh, that's actually really, really easy. That's how you get people in. It's called boiling the frog. Nobody that's like born a normal person.
No, you're
nobody that's
so disingenuous.
Whoa. Hold on.
You're boiling the frog because people who begin with left-wing ideas turn into genocide-denying Yankees.
Hold on. I love you, buddy. Listen, okay? So, most people aren't going to be susceptible to, like, neo-Nazi ideology. There's a big reason why a lot of figures have been outed as neo-Nazis over the last few years, especially Nicholas J. Fuentes himself used to be very crypto about it. There's a term called crypto-fash, or just being crypto, right? And the idea is that you mask your actual motivations behind memes and jokes and talking points that aren't necessarily as incendiary as what you truly believe, and it kind of helps ease them into taking the red pill. You know, it's very common. I've used to be part of the right. I used to hang out a lot in these spaces. I know exactly what the motivations are. I know how it's done. I was a victim of that same type of I guess you could say indoctrination. I know exactly how it works. It's not going to slip past me.
If I accused you of furthering a genocide denying tanky agenda, our credibility to our claims would practically be the same.
Sure. Accuse me of supporting tankies.
Okay.
You can have that argument.
You support tankies, and all you're doing is boiling the frog by being generally left-wing on the internet.
Okay. Do you have any evidence that I support tankies?
No, but,
I have evidence that you support Nazis. You're a fan of Nick Fuentes.
No. See,
you're a fan of one of the most popular online Nazi figures there is right now.
You keep trying to get away from the argument that I'm having.
Am I a friend with any tankies? Am I buddies with a tankie?
No.
Do you have any examples?
Look. Oh my gosh, what you're doing is obfuscating. I don't know what you do in private. Just because you don't overtly, by the way, what you're doing is simply playing
optics.
I
do lots of soaking
up
in private.
So just because you're covering up the fact that you talk to tankies, you're still furthering your leftist tanky agenda by talking about overtly left-wing things on the internet, which is an attempt to boil the frog by getting people into the left wing.
Comrade.
Mm-hmm.
Forget
yeah,
everything
so,
you have
so basically,
heard.
The most simple way I can say this is
you will
your
not get in the way
line
of our revolution.
Applies just as much to you as it does to me. And what I was interested in is having a conversation with you where you hold me accountable to my words. We could ask simple yes or no questions.
Your social credit score is dropping.
You could ask simple yes or no questions. You could ask me, Kai, do you believe this? I'll say yes. But at the end of the day, you would not take the answer that you don't want away, right? You would only take away what you want me to say. That's all you would take away. So is there any way to come out of this fruitful? Are you going to keep calling me something that I've said in this debate? I'm not.
I just think it's cute. You're dressed up like little Nicholas Fuentes. You got like the suit on and you talk the same way.
Nicholas J. Fuentes is the only person who's worn a suit. I'm familiar with that line of reasoning as well. If you'd like to
No, legitimately, like take a video of Nick Fuentes talking and like doing his show and take you and you got like the suit on. You have the same manner. Here, I want to see if I can do the mannerisms as well. You mind if I take a little bit of a straight
Yeah,
try?
Go ahead. But as long as we get back to the argument you pivoted from,
now, there's
fine.
A certain degree of value that we need to put on the culture of white people here in our hegemonic nation. It's hard to do because you guys talk in so many buzzwords and so much dog whistles and euphemisms. It's hard to like actually make any sense of it, so it makes it harder to do the impression. But I think I got the like general kind of thing down. I can go put on a suit if you like, and I can like really go hard into it. But like, I don't know, it's just like you've got the whole aesthetic going. You got the Nicholas Fuentes drip and you're doing the whole thing. Have you talked to him before? Are you like buddies with him or are you just like a fan?
I really don't think that if I said no, you'd believe me. So there's really no point in me answering any of your questions. When are you going to realize that you have such a preconceived notion of who I am that whatever I tell you, you're never going to take at face value? If somebody else tells you something about me that corresponds or that is in agreeance or in compliance with what you believe about me, you'll surely believe it. That doesn't even matter. The source, whether it's credible or not, doesn't matter either. But if you're actually interested in discussing what we've been discussing, the same way you were doing for an hour and a half before you simply said, hey, do you know this guy? Then we can actually get something productive out of this. Or maybe if you believe that you're going to represent your ideas so poorly, you can just stop having the debate. Because obviously, if you're platforming me and I'm winning, that's not a good look.
Yeah, no, I mean, I feel like I've already pretty much solidified that I'm right about this position. I mean, I've shown all the data and everything in it. And the idea that, like, it was hard to follow a lot of what you were saying early on. And I thought at first, maybe this guy's in good faith and he's really, like, just really knowledgeable about this topic. But it came very obvious to me that, like, the words you were saying made no sense. You were throwing in all these phrases that just have no value in the conversation. It's like you're trying to speak a different language. It's just made up of words that make you sound smart for the audience. And I've been very concise with my language. I haven't been using any, like, sort of ethereal like words that you can't really nothing that's tangible.
I've been asking words of those have evidence. I used? Which words have I used?
You've talked every time you talk about what culture is all about. You've been yet to point at anything that's like solid other than language.
And even then, you weren't able to back up that point. That just means that you haven't been listening to me, probably because you're reading another person tell you that I'm a fan of Nick Fuentes. So what did I say about China? What did I say the Chinese culture was?
Chinese culture was taking off your shoes, eating at different times of day, etc.
Well, there was one very particular one. It was an offspring of a Confucian tradition, of a particular set of values and the society it created. I've pointed to the Chinese society as something distinct, coming from a certain set of values with certain
Chinese
customs.
Do you think that Chinese society is the same as it was during the time of Confucius?
No, but I think that the effect of the Confucian practice has instrumentally or has critically shaped their society in a way that the United States simply hasn't. Thus, establishing the differences between cultures. I don't think I'm obfuscating.
I don't know if you simply can't follow that,
but I think I'm being very clear.
Do you think a white America would be preferable to a mixed ethnicity, mixed race America?
I think that's such a general question to bait me into something I don't mean. Do you want to ask something particular about like, hey, do you believe that, you know, like, do you buy into the idea that there are racial, you know, disharmonies, or that there's a kind of racial conflict that might be stoked by immigration? To which I would say, yes, I think that's an accurate thing to say. I think there is a kind of anti-white sentiment in this country. And if you would have asked me that an hour ago, I would have said exactly that. Because I'm interested in what optics really is, which is being as clear about my own beliefs as I can. Optics is being as clear about what you mean. If you obfuscate, you don't win. If you lie about what you actually believe, then the things you actually believe don't win. This should be clear as day. Optics is about being understood for what you really mean as clearly as possible.
So
that's not even the correct definition of optics.
What's your definition? When right-wingers lie to people?
No, I mean, optics is the way in which people view you. It's the impression you give off to people.
So if you give an incorrect impression, are you performing with good optics?
It depends on how people react. If you are giving...
You're retarded.
For example, I'm retarded?
Yes.
You seem to think so? You think that... So if you go out on the street and... or let's say Nick Fuentes goes out on the street and express... I'm sorry.
Move to Q&A.
No, I'm good. Hold on. I just want to make this last point. We can move on to Q&A. I think good optics is when your public-facing image is something that the general population responds to positively. And bad optics is when you do something that when people see it, they have a negative reaction from. Mm. So for example, I would say you saying retarded is probably bad optics to my audience because
the chat seemed to like it.
Well, not my chat, but I mean,
what?
I
no way, no way.
We have very different chats.
They're more mad at me that I repeated the word, but you know, it is what it is. So, for example, what you just said there would be considered bad optics by my audience, even though it was honest. It was you expressing how you felt about what I had just said, and yet it was still bad optics to my audience. Something being good optics, you could have said, well, then you're dumb, and I guess that would have been good optics. It would be like, oh, he called him dumb. That's like a little jab, you know? That is what good and bad optics are, at least as far as being a public figure and expressing your beliefs in the marketplace of ideas goes.
Yeah, that's called obfuscation. That's called lying about what you're about. I wouldn't say retarded if I was not inclined or if I didn't believe that was fine. So if I started going out saying like, you shouldn't say retarded, that'd probably be bad optics because it's not something I actually believe. Like I said before, optics is not just about how people see you. It's about them seeing you correctly and for who you really are because you don't benefit from having people believe that you're something you're not because every single time that happens, you get called out on it. It's not at all hard to be shown this image of somebody and see them like completely go against it and then say, wow, they are absolutely not who they said they are. And that would be bad optics. But
well,
anyway,
now I'm extra sure that I was right about the immigration thing because the optics argument is like pretty easy to just tell that you're wrong. I mean, I know what good and bad optics means. I'm a YouTuber. Every YouTube, regardless of your political affiliations, every YouTuber knows that. Corpse Husband knows that. PewDiePie knows that. Every single YouTuber or public figure knows what good and bad optics are. It's a thing that like you have to understand when it comes to public engagement. It's not good and bad optics isn't how genuine you are to your true beliefs and your true values. It's how people look at your behavior.
Well, I'm waiting to benefit from the things that are not actually what I believe. So anyway, we can move on to the Q&A.
Yeah, I'm happy to do the Q&A. I got my weed here. I'm ready to get a little stoned.
That's why this debate's been so bad. It's because you're smoking weed, which has a causal relationship with the decline of IQ. That's what it is every time.
It's going so smoothly.
That's not very impressive for you then if you just got blown the fuck out by a dude who's stoned as fuck.
I think there will even be people in your chat who say that Xander Hall, the pivot that you made by talking about Nick was one of the most dishonest things you've ever done. And it was easily a way to get away from a debate that Kai was about to engage in the way that I've been debating it for the last hour. So just that one moment, by the way, folks, was the thing that made Xander Hall so against having the rest of this debate. But we can jump to the Q&A.
Did you want to do closing statements or do you want to?
I mean, I'll give like an outro and stuff and just my main thesis statement, I guess, and, you know, my thoughts on the debate. I had fun. I know that we don't exactly see eye to eye, Kai Clips, and perhaps you don't agree that of my evaluation of you. But I appreciate you debating me today. I appreciate you taking time out of your day to do this. I had a lot of fun. I appreciate you, Brittany and Justin, for having me on today and all the lovely MILF questions. I think overall it was pretty productive. I mean, I had a fun time. I'm about to play some Destroy All Humans remastered on my stream if anyone wants to watch that. And yeah, you know where to find me. Thank you for watching, everybody, and I will see you all later.
Well, hold on. Before you go, I do want to say, you know, I enjoyed the debate too. I thought we actually had a really good debate. It's actually one of the best immigration debates we've had, or I've had to this point. So I genuinely do appreciate you coming on. I wish it didn't go the way it did at about the 1 hour mark. But again, I don't think there's anything I could say that could change your mind because you've articulated that you won't take me at my word. So I guess I'll kind of finish it there. I think my points throughout the argument stood. I would have loved to get into, you know, a bunch of stuff more on social cohesion, social capital and whatnot. But I think that's where we'll leave it. You can find me on Kai Clips, KAIKLIPS on Instagram and Kai Clips on YouTube, KAICLIPS.
Cool.
Well, Kai, I'd say I fucked you in this debate, but out of respect for your religion, I will say that I soaked you.
Mike.
Have a good one. That was a good outro. I had to slip that in there. I had to slip that in there right at the end. I promised Cherry, because of the Mormonism stuff, I promised I had to make a good Mormon joke right at the end. I promised Cherry I'd do that. I'm going to be completely honest with all of you guys. I knew that he was a Nazi going in. I knew that he was a Nick Fuentes fan. I'd had my editor do a little bit of research on him and like figure out what he believed, what his affiliations were, the kind of shit he was saying when he wasn't on stream debating. So I already knew from the beginning, that he was a Nazi, but I wanted to see how long he would let the charade go on. And then sure enough, you know, and then obviously we've got the accounts called Adolf Hitler coming into YouTube chat and stuff like that. So that also gives like pretty obvious impression of who we're talking about here. Right. Anyway, if you enjoyed that debate, thank you so much for watching. It was a fun time. Be sure to subscribe, ring the bell icon, follow my Twitter, Instagram, TikTok, all that, all linked down below. Join the fan Discord as well, if you like. And of course, you can support me financially by donating, subscribing, gifting a sub, or whatever, over on Streamlabs or my website if you want to support me. Anyway, thank you so much for watching, and have a good one.